So Jaina actually makes a little bit of sense there, because it's easy to hit Blizzard on Arthas and at least get two of the hits if you hit it if he's trying to go for an engage.
All right, so that means now as well with those bans with Rengar gone, that means they're probably forced into Brightwing unless they want to go down a lesser route of something like a Karazim, etc. But I doubt they would go that way. Auriel and Uther are in Nappa's hero pool. He can use them. It's not like they're unknown commodities, but let's see what Team Expert's going to go for. I would love the Medivh. I would absolutely love the Medivh. Leoric and Volstad.
Nice. So now we have the Entomb into Mighty Gust combo, and it's a combo that actually can do well against Arthas, but also Ragnaros to a degree, and you get Isolation. The good thing, too, is that you naturally think that you want to go down the path of Auriel here because you have Vala, but
yeah.
Leoric says, I dare you. Please,
yes.
Go Auriel here. You're able to get into an engage. You can force an Aegis, and then you get the follow-up, false set again with the Mighty Gust. There's so many things that really work here with the Leoric pick.
Yeah, Vala's positioning is going to have to be key. The Entomb into Vala trying to vault anywhere other than forwards is lullable, is the best way to describe that.
Expert right now is a little bit lackluster on damage, though. While Falstad can be quite the pain, he's not the guy that really is going to be front-loading and offloading all the damage to kill off somebody. So we're going to need to send something there. There's that Tyrael with the Arthas, so we have the Tricked Esport duo foundation that they love. Brightwing isn't the healer that probably wanted to have overall. I think Leoric being here just really said, all right, we can't go Auriel. So they're going to have a hard time dealing with Major Burst. Luckily for them, Expert doesn't have insane damage, so Brightwing can live here. The pick for Team Expert needs to be instrumental.
Well, it's ADRD, so what are we going for? Who knows at that point? You know, Medivh is still up if he wants him, but...
Zul'jin, let's go. We saw him in North America.
Yeah, we did. We did.
I do want an auto attacker or some burst. Li Ming could work here, but Li Ming has a hard time around the shrines. Arthas is a good frontline against that. And Tyrael is also a thing, too, so Li Ming's kind of hard to pull off. You kind of force Falsehood to go into auto attack build, but that doesn't scale into the late game. And at that point, you may have lost a couple of shrines already.
Show us something crazy.
I'm trying to just go through my mind here. I mean, you could go for a melee assassin. Illidan could be okay here, but they have Brightwing and Tyrael and double tank. Let's
there
see. Kerrigan's still up, by the way, too. And it's going to be Sylvanas.
It's not that crazy. Sorry.
Okay. So they're just going for the control of the battlegrounds here. And then if they get a shrine, they get the advantage with Sylvanas. I feel like damage is slightly lacking here overall for this team, especially against a double tank. Luckily, with Brightwing being forced to be picked here, they kind of have smaller heals to deal with. But it's still a thing that I don't know if they have real kill potential unless they get isolation first.
Right. It's more about... A slow and steady death.
Yeah.
Drain Hope comes to mind.
Drain Hope. Mosh pits have to be key, and then you have the good hammering to follow up, and then you can maybe get a kill from there. It's a composition that I only believe an expert to pull off here against what they're facing off against.
Right. I was expecting maybe a bit more of a Wilder pick towards the end, but Sylvanas, she's in this weird spot, I suppose, in Europe where she does survive later on down into drafts, and you're like, we're on Infernal Shrines. Of course, Sylvanas could be really good. Yeah, all thumbs up and all that funzy. Is that what it's called? I don't know.
Yeah, it's funsies. That's definitely a word out here. Funzies.
I'm not American. I have no clue. But
we will get you brought up while you teach me Europe stuff. I'll teach you American stuff. We'll get some hamburgers. We'll get some fries. Yep. We'll get some Sour Patch Kids. Let's do it. Let's do the life here.
All about the Sour Patch Kids.
See, the thing about the comp last game, we also felt that they were a little bit lackluster on damage, but they had the Saphira Smash, which is one of those things that you just delete somebody. And they also had the vulnerability with Sylvanas at level 16, so Sylvanas drops vulnerability, Ragnaros comes in, kills somebody. But that damage isn't available here as big as you would like. It's going to be on Falstad here to make sure that he's slamming multiple hammerings and that they work in those auto attacks. And, of course, as you mentioned, Leoric is able to get in that front line and hopefully get some drain hopes. It looks like we are ready for game number 3. Can Expert finish it with a 3-0, or is Tricked Esport going to start the comeback?
Alrighty, I would love to see it go on a little bit further beyond our 3-0 potential that we're seeing from the team on the left-hand side in the blue. It is Team Expert, as we do have, not that gentleman. It will be ADRD on the Falstad. We have Nick going to be playing Sylvanas, Bad Benny on ETC, Kersen on Malfurion, and finally Blade will be on Leoric.
And on the right side for the red team, it will be a Thurnal here for Tyrael Crosby, pulling out the Vala Nappa here on the Brightwing Rimmer. with the Ragnaros, and in the top, Alex the Progy playing the hero he loves dearly. It's going to be Arthas.
All right, so let's see how this is going to play out, obviously. Nick on the Sylvanas is something that is an interesting talking point to me. I don't get to see him quite as often playing on something like that. I'm normally seeing him on like Tychus, on the Valor, on some other things if he gets kind of locked out of those spots. But so it's gonna be cool to watch him play in that out.
All right, Runaway. Blade moves in and starts as the wave player. He will be the major wave player for this team, so you're going to see Blade doing a lot of rotations. Sylvanas will help out as well when they do get on the turrets. And the bottom, we already have the Engagement and Curry.
Yeah, you know what? It's funny that I say that, because we did just see him play it in the previous game. So
Sylvanas on Nick?
Yeah,
he played it well.
Yeah, he did.
He had a solid Sylvanas. Yeah. He made sure to work in that tray. I mean, most of the time when you're playing Sylvanas and you're trying to judge how good of a Sylvanas player is, you see where they're getting their value in terms of turning off forts and their kiting potential.
Yes, yeah, very much so. He was able to use his Haunting Wave effectively and still dishing out damage while that was all going on. Eternal on the Tyrael is going to be cool to watch. It really plays well with his playstyle. You know, he is that melee assassin that just wants to go in deep. Tyrael is kind of that same air about him with just a little bit more sustainability, so.
I am happy to see here that Expert is going Seasoned Marksman with Falstad, which is a key indicator that they're probably going for an auto-attack build, which again is fantastic when you get to the late game. Falstad starts to hit like a truck when he has some marksman stacks going, and his scaling once he hits around like 13 to 16 is just a massive punch to the face, and Arthas will have to deal with that as well as Tyrael later on.
So one thing that is a talking point on this map, Trixler, is who has Shrine power? What do you think when you look at these compositions? Who has the better time on Shrine?
I think if it goes for a long duration, I look at Expert.
Yeah.
Because they have Leoric, they can sacrifice the death, maybe get a trade-off. Okay, Esports. Trick getting picked off there with Ragnaros being a tad bit on the aggressive side. Got to be careful there until Resilient Flame pops up. Mm. And that is actually a key indicator here for Team Expert to move in and start grabbing the shrines. Sylvanas and Malfurion have good abilities for doing the last second kill, so if there's like a trade-off going on, Malfurion can finish up with a Moonfire, take a couple of those away from the opponent. But you look at Trixie Sport, and they have Ragnaros, Interior, and Vala, and they do a really solid job, especially with multi-shot build and Ragnaros' Q, of clearing those minions quickly. So if they are up front and they're quickly and don't lose Rimmer early, they can win the Shrine phase. But that death from Ragnaros was so painful that Expert takes the first Shrine.
Yeah, most definitely. I got to agree with you. That's it's got a snowball effect, unfortunately, there for Trixie Sport. Now, interesting to note that, of course, it wouldn't be an ADRD hero without him doing something a little bit off the mark, which I'm not saying off the mark, just off meta, which is Caesar Marksman on that Falstad. It's not entirely off meta. Sometimes you do see it, but a lot of the European players, when you see auto-attack-ish builds for Falstad, will say, okay, they have quite a strong frontline that doesn't have too much potential to lock me down. I can avoid most of their stuns. So I'm just going to wail away at those guys and get out some really good damage with extra damage on my auto-attacks and cause problems.
Yeah, it'll be a pain, especially in the late game, man. After that, too, he also got Static Shield, which allows for him to deal with Arthas much better. Arthas, again, having the armor available for him is going to be somewhat resistant against the auto-attacks coming from Falstad, but you get a W in there, he gets a little bit close, you can chunk him for a slight amount and make him think twice about going for the full engage. Now, the Shrine didn't get too much of an advantage down there in the bottom lane. Ragnaros being here is just really good for wave clear and really good for tanking those shots that come your way, especially from Sylvanas. It's a bit of a soft counter, if you will.
All right, so just cleaning up one of the Khazra camps towards the mid lane. And now it's all the question of where our next shrine is going to be. So either top or mid, considering that one down, pushed down on towards the bottom. Now, if it was mid, there are towers already down, you can see here, for Team Expert, which would make a great opportunity if they were able to grab that. It's all about where the towers are down, because then you can launch a really lethal attack.
I like how Expert is moving between bottom lane and middle lane and using Sylvanas in this way. It forces responses from happening, and that gives them invade potential. As they go from bottom to top, and they can realize, all right, Arthas is top lane. If Arthas isn't here, they don't really have a strong front line to hold us from fully engaging. Bad Benny can go for the engage, Falstad can fly down, it can get picks while taking mercenary camps. So it's good rotation from them. Them now getting the mercenaries in the bottom at this point could work out for them to get the shrine if it spawns in the top. So they get a rotate and they get a fort.
And speaking of game forts, they're doing very well down here, indeed, especially with the Khazra camp helping out. Jeez, Team Expert, they really know how to exploit Sylvanas when they've been given a little bit of room.
For the most part, Strict Esports has done a good job of holding this. In terms of levels, they're only about a half a level behind, maybe three quarters, but regardless, it can snowball quickly when you have the Sylvanas on the opposing team if you don't react accordingly. And you can find yourself almost a level and a half to two levels behind in the early game. And they're only about a level behind. So that's actually a really good job by them. They just need to get to level 10 after this. The thing is, the Shrine is activating. And if Falsec continues to keep clearing, getting Marksman stacks, they're going to get 10 and they're going to get the Shrine, which means Expert has a chance of pushing into the fort in the top right with a heroic advantage.
This is the best Shrine, I feel, for Trixie Esports, if it's to go over the way to Team Expert, because they do have a wall available to them. Arthur's taking a lot of damage. That was a good power slide from Bambenny to try and lock him down. Doesn't quite get the kill there. Blade will just Wraith walk away. Remember, he doesn't have Hardened Bones at level 4, so he is taking still the normal, a sizable amount of damage whilst he's in Wraith Walk. He's opted to go for that Drain build, which, you know, we were saying that Drain Hope is going to be pivotal against that kind of frontline warrior.
Yeah, it will be. Trixie Esports took a bit of a gamble here coming up here, trying to get into the fight. Sadly, Arthas took way too much damage for them to get to an engagement. But the thing that really hurt them is they left a camp in the middle lane alone, and it burned down a few of the minions and started getting some pressure on the fort. So they didn't get really any advantage from coming up here. The hope was to get into a fight, get one or two picks, grab the Shrine, and get to level 10. And it just didn't pay off.
The Malfurion curse, that's right. He hasn't had as much of a win rate compared to, say, like Rhaegar during HGC Europe. That was ambitious, but a good cleanse comes out from Nappy onto Crosby to make sure he's freed. And now they're just stalling this.
Yeah, some would say that is not a good ult to pull off. It's wasted. But at that point, Team Expert had ults and the opponents didn't. So it's kind of a freebie to throw out there as long as you're not wasting too many. Granted, it is a long cooldown, but they do get cleanse out of it, which means that we can have an Entomb into a Mighty Gust, and there's no way if they follow up with another stun from ETC that Trick Esports can save that member that gets picked off.
Molten Core Pop looking to bring this Punisher down, as it is an Arcane Punisher doing a lot of damage, but it looks like Ragnaros will get thrown out of there quite quickly, and now it's being locked down. Nick is in range of this, so they're going to get a lot of damage done to it. This fort is almost a guaranteed sacrifice, unless we see an engagement from Trick soon.
They're looking for it. This is one of the problems, though, when it comes to Arthas, is he just can't quite get the engage unless somebody has already started it or he gets a flank. They just couldn't chase up, and this fort is taking some damage here from the Punisher and the poke. Now, Team Expert doesn't intend to actually finish this. They put Leoric in the middle just to keep soaking.
I think that's knock-on effects. I think that they wouldn't, Trixie Esports wouldn't have felt as comfortable pushing them back away from that fort if Mosh Pit hadn't been used. You could see Alex the Pro G keeping eyes on Bad Benny towards the bottom, but they're not as afraid because there isn't that big potential for a lockdown.
That is very true. That's one of the situations if you're trying to use a solo Mosh, it may not work out, you are kind of hurting for the next 120 seconds. Now, something to know is actually I like the pickup of Static Charge from Falsec at level 4 more now. When I think about Ragnaros going into Molten Core, you just get absolutely free damage because you drop the W on the Ragnaros, and one of the problems is that the opponent will just walk away. But Ragnaros can't walk away, so you actually get full value out of doing that, and you also get a shield procced up. So another nice pick there just to point out what we have there on Falsec. A pickoff on Brightwing as you hear that Fairy Dragon just scream in death.
You know the funny thing is that actually, Nappy did a great job of getting away from the Twilight Dream with a Blink Heal, but Blade was waiting in the wings to get him.
Power slide?
Oh my god, Valor gets blown up under the pressure of that, and that is going to be a wall, and this could be keep, actually, if they push on without Valor there.
That was quite the oopsie-daisy movement. Not really, you have your support there for Clinch. There goes the Power Slide into a Mosh. Isolations keep continuing here for Expert. Trick Esport looks like they may be falling apart here in game number 3. This keep with Sylvanas pushing in is guaranteed to go down.
Oh my god, great pressure from them. And again, Sylvanas coming in towards the very end of the draft enables all of this. So it goes to show that she's still an absolute playmaker, but kudos to the rest of the team for catching the members when they did.
At 9 minutes and 30 seconds, we have catapult pressure in the top lane for Expert already. Nice job for them. Leoric and Falsec will be split pushing here as Leoric goes down the bottom. keeping up with the experience lead. It's one of the things that you have to do when you have a damage comp that isn't really bringing as much damage as you normally would like. You have to stay ahead in the advantage and experience. And Leeward and Fawcett has been enabling that like no other. Now Mad Mini and the rest of the crew are here and are ready and willing to go for a fight. Sanctification is down for 30 seconds, but so is Moshpit for a full minute.
It sort of feels like Team Expert is saying, we don't have Tychus, but it doesn't really matter because we've got Lyrically Drain Hope and we've got False Stab with Giant Killer. So any warrior that does step out of place here for Trick Esport is going to get heavily punished. Alex the Pro G is in the thick of things. He might be the target, and that is a good Entomb there to try and start things off, but a great Reign of Vengeance to counter the position.
Good Entomb, but no major follow-up. This is where False Stab really starts to bring in the damage here with that Giant Killer that you were mentioning. You see a Thurnal there with two auto attacks, goes down to half health and W here. Bad Benny is retreating low on HP. It sounds like Malfurion uses Twilight Dream as well, but the Shrine still goes over to the control of Nick and his team. He's going to drop off a dagger there to slow down the retreat of the opposing team, and Bad Benny's looking for more. Does he have the power slide? In 10 seconds, he will have a mosh pit. Alex the Pro G in trouble, will get isolated, and there's the root.
Yeah, and he didn't have his ghouls either, unfortunately, so he will end up falling. That's what we're talking about when it comes to the damage that they can put out against that, so ignore that. Yeah, this is the perfect play. Ignore the fall. It doesn't matter. It's going to die to a Punisher. They can't force the leap. So go to the wall, start bringing down this, and then try and get on another keep to extend your lead, Expert.
Expert charges in, starts bringing out the arcane or the Punisher here. We already have Molten Core being popped, but they all just right-click Rimmer Baller down. Can they get the isolation? There's the Entomb. The Power Slide is still up here. He hasn't had to use it. A stun comes out. There's the Power Slide, and Rimmer is taken away here. 16 to 13 into levels, and the keep is dying.
And that's going to be a mosh on towards the target as well, up towards the top. There was a small little move there that I'll elaborate on just later, but now they are looking for big, big damage here, Trick.
Going straight for the core. 16 seconds before we have a Ragnaros, 23 seconds before we have a Vala. The damage is non-existent for Trick Esport. They're going to have a hard time holding this. It doesn't look like they can here. Nape working in every single auto attack he can, and that is the core falling 30, 20%, 10%. 10%, 0%, GG Team Expert wins the series 3-0.
We asked the question at the beginning of the series, who out of these two teams will solidify themselves as a fourth strong spot here in HGC Europe and potentially move on to challenge for those top three spots? I think we just got our answer very convincingly.
I think I have to agree with you. Expert is officially now the penultimate boss. They are the bosses before the big final boss of Dignitas, Misfits, and of course Fnatic. So, crazy game overall. Yeah. Expert just seems to understand what they have to do with every single composition. That's what I like about them, versatility.
Yeah, it's definitely, they're so well coordinated. And one thing that I wanted to point out towards that final kill on Ragnaros, where they actually got the Entomb on him just as he's coming out of Molten Core, is that, so they didn't know that Sanctification was still on cooldown for another 5 seconds or so. But you could see ADRD, knowing that they wanted to get that kill on Ragnaros, he gusted away Eternal on the Ethereal, so he couldn't Elder Runes might in and Sanctification to try and save the Ragnaros. It doesn't matter what it was. The point is that they didn't save him. They couldn't save him. All of these little moves string together to make Expert the experts.
Yeah, it was actually insane. It seemed like every single team fight came down to an isolation first, and then it became a 5v4. There was never a scenario where Expert put themselves in a position to be in a straight-up 5v5, where an Arthas could flank or a Tyrael could move in on the maneuver. They just did such a good job of finding targets that were just slightly overextended away from their team, whether it be the entire team was retreating because they knew that they didn't win the Shrine, and so they had a chase down, and all these factors. They really did a great job of just running that composition, making sure Falsehead had the follow-up and they had the roots and the entombs to win every single trade-off. So nice job by them. Gotta love Expert. And they will move up to 2-0. They're actually the first team that we have in the standings right now with a 2-0.
They haven't dropped a map.
They have not dropped a map. Bad Benny. Hello, can you hear us? Hello, Bad Benny. First off, congratulations on being the first 2-0 in the entire tournament. How does it feel?
Feels good. Feels good.
I like how
and
cutthroat
doing
you
are. 3-0 instead of 3-1 as Fnatic did. Also a bonus.
Well, speaking about it, let's just talk about your versatility. It seems like you guys have been really just hammering out being flexible overall. What's the main thing you guys are trying to do to make sure that you can adapt to every single team?
To be honest, we don't really care about the other teams. We care about us. Like, we want to be able to play anything. So everyone just practice everything. Like, they should be able to play their heroes so we can draft whatever is needed, whatever ADR thinks is best, basically.
I was thinking to myself, both of us were thinking about how this match was going to go between Expert and Tricked. We saw this as kind of like the battle for fourth place and then to see who could go above fourth place. How did you anticipate the series going? Did you expect a 3-0 or did you expect them to give you more trouble?
I think that if we dropped a game, it would have maybe been like 3-2 or like been much closer. But since we had a momentum, we were able to like steamroll through.
Right.
I think they're very good, but our drafting is way superior, and that's why we're winning.
Okay.
Like a big reason, at least.
Bad Benny, thank you so much for joining us. Congratulations on being 6-0, actually, because you guys did well against Diamond Skin as well. You guys are wonderful, and we'll see you next time. Awesome, guys. That's going to be HGC Europe for the first match. We're getting ready for the second series of the day, the one that everyone's been talking about, Misfits taking on Fnatic. I can't wait for it. How about you, Kolaris?
Me neither. Again, this is going to be my highlight of the week across all regions. Fnatic going up against Misfits. Tell everybody to tune in.
Yeah, make sure you're tweeting it out. Everyone know on HGC. Use the hashtags, all that fun stuff. For me, I think it's going to go to game five, no matter what. I feel like these two teams are just so fist and fist, right? They're just going to punch into each other. They're such great haymakers when it comes down to it. But let's go ahead and look at our standings and see where everyone is currently residing in the entire setup here. So, let's check out the schedule here. Trick Esport taking on Team Expert. We saw that just occur. A 3-0 victory here for Team Expert. Congratulations to them. Now, coming up at 11:30 a.m. Pacific Standard Time, 8:30 p.m. CET, Misfits Fnatic, the match that Kolaris and I were just talking about. And then later on for North America, if you guys want to hang around, grab some pizza, and hang out for more games, B-Step and Team 8 will be facing off Team Niventic, Gale Force Esports. We'll have Dredd and Gilly covering those games for you. But I just want to get into the next match. That's all I care about right now in my small life right now. I want Misfits and Fnatic. I want to sink my teeth into it.
To plant the seed before we end up going to a break and waiting for these teams to get ready, this is the match that denied Misfits going to BlizzCon. When they were playing in the European regionals over at Gamescom, Fnatic denied them in the very last map in that last series from going to BlizzCon. A tournament that Misfits was hungry for, a tournament that Misfits thought that they deserved to be at because of their strength and power in the European scene. So they're going to want revenge.
Oh, they are definitely going to want that redemption. They've already mentioned it before in past interviews. We'll talk about it more as we go into the series. But for today, the highlights so far for what we've seen here in the HGC. Here we are.
Just waiting on the edge of those
it's me.
Routes.
That's you.
And we'll move away.
This entire fight. They just turn it around so well here. Tricked Esport and Team Expert floating around.
Watch where Eternal here tries to go for the swap in, and then this causes absolute breakdown very, very soon. So tries to go in, swap. Doesn't swap them over the wall, unfortunately, for him. It's like a little bit out of tandem, and then it all melts down from there.
Yeah, unfortunately, and there was the ADRD follow-up with the damage there from Ragnaros. The AoE so strong in the area, and Alex Aproji just a little too late coming off the death spawn, and that was a kill there on all of Team Expert.
They really felt like they wanted to do something, or had to do something, I think, during all of that. And what else is going on here?
This was a fight where it was the boss. It was a 3v5.
Yes.
And we had, in the bottom left, Eternal was just going off on Zeratul, taking out Nick.
It felt like this is the one moment, actually, of Team Expert that kind of felt like uncoordinated and off. None of the three members down towards that bottom corner knew whether they wanted to fight or escape through a portal. Yeah. So they were always just taking massive AoE damage there from even just a Dahaka, which can do big AoE damage. Yeah, kind of crumbled there.
Well, if you enjoyed those highlights, make sure to check it all out on our YouTube. We've been, of course, showing everything there. Heroesofstorms.com/esports. You can find everything about the HGC. We'll be back with our next match after this commercial break.
Are known across the whole of Azeroth. My eldest brother Magni was king of Ironforge, wise and fair a ruler as ever been. And Bran, well, he's a renowned explorer, always finding secrets. Being written about in Explorer's League Geographic. With brothers like that, I'd feel a wee bit overshadowed. If I didn't kick so much ass! Ha ha ha! All right, lads, line up! It's hammer time!
Just fine.
Been called a lot of things.
A renegade, an outlaw. Guilty as charged.
Makes life exciting. You never know who
or what will be on your side. So when the Nexus King called, there was only one thing to say. Hell, it's about time.
Stitches what say? Stitches what playtime? Stitches play too rough. No one play with Stitches. But Stitches found Nexus. In Nexus, everyone have to play with Stitches. So much playtime makes Stitches hungry.